So hello and welcome to the opening SB 56 press conference. We're very mindful of the fact that the opening plenary has overdrawn by about 3 hours. And because of that, most journalists who are here have actually gone home. But we do know that there are about 300 people watching via YouTube, and we have the BBC here in the room. So we're very happy to take questions. We're also happy to take questions virtually via the SB56 virtual platform. And without further ado, I would like to hand over to Patricia Espinosa, the Executive Secretary of UN Framework Convention on Climate Change.
Thank you, John. And dear colleagues, welcome to all to those of you who came to Bonn, but also welcome to everyone who is online. And I want to start by thanking you for your interest in these meetings, for your interest in the climate change process, and for the fact that you will allow us to enhance the messages that are coming out of these meetings. These meetings are normally referred to as the technical meetings of preparations for the conference. But in fact, you know, these are, I would say, more than technical meetings. These are meetings where we can already start seeing how what would be the best way to address some of the contentious issues that will be coming up or that are there, and that will need to be resolved in whatever outcome we have at the conference. These discussions have also a special meaning, because we do know that the subsidiary bodies meetings are taking place in the context of a world that is nothing like what we saw in Glasgow. The world is being impacted by progress, significant progress on climate change, including the disruption of global energy markets, including clean energy investments. And we also are experiencing a food crisis, as well, what we see is a risk of seeing some of the financial resources that we need to address the greening of the economies in the developing world, especially going to other other purposes. This is, of course, all of this adds to the urgency of addressing climate change, to the need that we really are able to show that we have achieved progress at this meeting. What does this mean for the preparations at for COP27? First of all, I think we have to be very conscious of the fact that when the world meets in Sharm el-Sheikh, the world, the international community, the overall public, everywhere will be hearing one question, which is, what have you done since Glasgow? Where is the progress? How can you demonstrate that we are on the right track? And these questions are, of course, difficult questions in the context that I have just described, and the fact that we know that we are still very, very far from where we need to be in order to secure the 1.5 degree goal. It's going to be a COP where we certainly would like to see, and we hope to see, a focus on implementation. In Glasgow, the international community managed to finalize all the elements of the implementation guidelines of the Paris Agreement. And this means that now we have all the instruments that are needed. So now nations will need to show how they will, through their legislations, through their policies, through their programs, through their institutional frameworks, implement the commitments that they made in Glasgow, or even some of them before the conference. And here I'm referring, of course, to the contents of the nationally determined contributions, but also the national adaptation plans. So what do we need to achieve here at the subsidiary bodies meeting? We need to show progress on the issues that we will be addressing in Sharm el-Sheikh. And it is important to bear in mind that all these issues are interrelated and are interdependent. So, and the fact that the outcome from Sharm el-Sheikh, as was the case in Paris, as was the case in Glasgow and in many others, all the other conferences, it needs to be a balanced outcome, an outcome that addresses mitigation, that addresses adaptation, and that addresses means of implementation. In particular, finance, but not only finance, also capacity building and transfer of technology. And of course, loss and damage has come out of the Glasgow conference also as one of the issues that needs to be addressed. It has been for a long time a very contentious issue, but I do believe that it is time now that we address it in an open, constructive, and respectful manner. Regarding finance, of course, the issue of the 100 million pledge that should be mobilized in order to support the efforts of developing countries is still outstanding. Countries are still expecting to see that become a reality. I certainly hope that we will get some good news, but I am also very conscious of the fact that this is a particularly difficult moment regarding finance. However, it is important. It is important to create the right atmosphere, an atmosphere of trust between all the parties that need to come together one more time and show that the world is united in order to address climate change. regarding mitigation. Mitigation, very important point that was achieved in Glasgow was the recognition of the fact that the five-year cycle that is embedded in the Paris Agreement regarding nationally determined contributions is not enough, is not sufficient to allow us to progress towards the 1.5 degree goal, and therefore that parties should make of the review of their nationally determined contributions, their national climate action plans, a permanent process in order to look continuously at opportunities to increase ambition and allow us to be closer to the goal. That's not yet looking well. We have received so far only a few updated NDCs. We need to get more updated NDCs. The Secretariat has communicated to the parties that in the case of those who may find difficult to make a whole exercise of updating their national action plans, they could also report to us the progress that they have made in implementing what they have already committed, but also maybe some areas of opportunity that are not yet incorporated fully into the NDCs, but maybe may be a part of the NDCs in the future. All of this is in order for the Secretariat to be able to give the best possible picture, the most credible picture of where we all are regarding our efforts to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. In addition to the NDCs, of course, we also need to see the long-term climate strategies from countries. And there is really, this is a big area where we know the world will be watching and will want to know exactly where we are. Adaptation, as you may remember, adaptation was very clearly addressed at the conference in Glasgow as one of the main concerns of the most vulnerable developing countries. In fact, for the most vulnerable and in general, there was broad recognition of the importance of the adaptation, even also of the fact that adaptation is an agenda that needs to be addressed everywhere, not only in the developing world and not only in the countries that are the most vulnerable. There was a decision to start a process in order to define a new global goal on adaptation. And that conversation will start here in Bonn. So countries have been, especially developing countries, have been very, very eager to see that particular issue reflected in the agenda and to have enough time to exchange on that issue. Regarding loss and damage, beside the making the Santiago network fully operational, Santiago Network is a network that intends to provide technological and other advice to developing countries on the issues of loss and damage. So that needs to become fully operational. That's also an area where we need to see progress at this session. But in addition to that, there needs to be also progress on the Glasgow dialogue on finance that could be dedicated to the issue of loss and damage. And that also is a conversation that needs to start now at this particular session. Another important piece that will be discussed here is the preparations for the global stocktake that should provide detailed information for countries and stakeholders on where we are in addressing climate change, not only regarding mitigation, but also many other aspects as well. The technical dialogue that we will hold here will allow parties to start identifying where are the existing gaps and hopefully also how to address them. So, dear colleagues, I believe that this conference marks the start of a new phase in our intergovernmental climate change process, a phase of implementation. We have a blueprint and we have a framework and we have the rules to ensure that it is transparent. So I think it's time to get on with the job, and I would maybe only add that it has been very reassuring to see how much interest and the really very high participation, not only from governments, but also from other stakeholders, and high interest in this session as we progress towards the COP27 in Sharm el-Sheikh in Egypt. Thank you. Thank you, John.
Thank you very much, Patricia. So you said yourself, the eyes of the world are upon us. also virtually, but we have a couple of people here in the room. Would there be any questions from the floor? Yes, please go ahead. Hang on, can you just wait till you have a microphone, please?
So because the next COP will be in Africa, main issues would be adaptation and loss and damage. And Glasgow also set in place a lot of movement for this by coming up with the loss and damage dialogue and the global goal on adaptation. But how come both of these were not even on the agenda until LMDC group actually put forth a proposal for the same? And also recently, just a few minutes ago, in the SBI plenary, we saw a lot of contention between a lot of parties, especially developed and developing, talking about how mitigation and adaptation are not being treated as the same. So what are your comments on it? Because this has been a long-standing issue that adaptation never gets as much preference as mitigation does. And I saw this right now at the plenary also. And yeah, summing up the first question, how come loss and damage and adaptation were not even on the agenda until a specific proposal was put forth?
Thank you. Thank you very much for that question. Well, first of all, let me start by saying that, as we all know, this is a party-driven process, and the provisional agenda that is prepared for consideration of the parties is a proposal based on the normally on a very detailed analysis of the different mandates that have been derived from the previous conference and also from other conferences before. So the fact is that according to the agreements in Glasgow, the global goal on adaptation and the Glasgow dialogue on loss and damage should start with some technical workshops. And of course, the arrangements for all those technical workshops were made. So the fact that the issues were not in the initial agenda or proposed agenda didn't mean that they were the issues were being ignored. Actually, the Secretariat, in consultation with the chairs of the subsidiary bodies, we were making all the preparations for that. Having said that, I understand the interest of developing countries in particular to have these agenda items reflected. As we could hear from the discussions in the room, I think it becomes very obvious how much the agenda itself is also part of that very delicate balance that needs to be crafted among the different elements of the climate change regime. Mitigation, adaptation, loss and damage, means of implementation, etc. I think and I hope that this will be a good opportunity for parties to engage in an exercise of really looking into the agenda of the subsidiary bodies and the conference in order to streamline it and strengthen it so that parties can, under that agenda, concentrate in on the issues that are of highest interest to them, and that we can have also do it in a way that is balanced. Yes, I mean, we have seen in the past also that agenda becomes part of the substantive negotiation. I am very happy for the results until now. I know that the SBI chair will continue to do some consultations on the issue related to the Glasgow dialogue on loss and damage. I hope that will also come to a positive compromise so that we can move forward as swiftly as possible. Because what is true is that one thing is very clear. We don't have time. And it is very important that we use the time to concentrate on all those issues that where the international community need to come together and work together.
Okay, I'm just getting the message that the time has already expired for our virtual platform. Unfortunately, it was only set till 4:30, which is why we're not getting questions via the virtual platform. Sorry about that. But would there be any other questions from the room? If not, we'll keep things short. Oh, you have a second question.
Is there a way that we can send them an email or something so that if they have questions, they can send them to us? I just feel so.
Yeah. Or perhaps with the virtual platform, would there be a way of extending the time that we've been allotted? Can that happen at short notice?
Or just any kind of chat there where everybody and somebody could give it to them so that they can send their questions.
Yeah, I think it's a bit too short notice for that. We were relying on the virtual platform being active, but I'm afraid there's been a glitch there.
It's unfortunate.
Sorry about that.
It's unfortunate.
So let's
please,
continue
I am
here.
Sorry to interrupt you.
No, that's okay. No, just the second question that I asked about balancing between mitigation and adaptation. This is what a lot of developing countries have been concerned about, that both are not being treated as equal. Just your comments on that.
Well, it's always a difficult task to achieve that balance, right? When we listen to some of the conversations, and you know, it's just observing the process. In some cases, you hear that balance is somehow related, or some delegations see balance related to the time allocated for discussion of each item, which I think is one aspect, but maybe it's not all of it. It depends also, in my view, on the use you make of that time. It depends also on how much you manage to get the discussion into exactly the issues that are important to be presented there. So, and please don't take this as a judgment on anyone. I think what is very important is that we are really well prepared for all of these discussions, and we try to make them productive in a way that allows parties to concentrate on the specific issues that need to be at the center of the conversation. I am in my intervention this morning, I was alluding to the need to make the process very efficient, because we don't have time. And in my view, that means that we should also hopefully be able to get a process that is expedite in addressing the substantive issues, and hopefully also bringing forward conclusions that allows us to move forward. It is difficult. Almost 200 countries that are that get together in these conferences. It's really not an easy task, but I think there is no choice, and we need to try to do that.
Okay, there would be the possibility of asking questions on YouTube. So anybody who is joining via YouTube right now can ask a question if they are from the media. So we'll just wait a second. Would you like to take that question?
Can you read it, please?
well. Well, there has been the question about how the war in Ukraine could possibly be impacting the negotiations. Would you like to take that?
Well, as I have said before, you know, of course, I am concerned about the effects of this war in Ukraine. It has, I was mentioning before, the disruption in energy markets, the food security crisis, the fact that, you know, resources may be shifting away from the needs of resources for greening the economies in developing countries. So I think all of those are potential effects. But even in this very difficult situation, and when we are all really looking at, hopefully, good solutions and peaceful solution to the conflict, we need to continue working to bring the agenda on climate change forward.
Just seeing if there are any further questions on YouTube, but I think that's it for the time being. So yes, I think we need to bring things to an end now. Thank you very much, Patricia Espinosa. This is your final press briefing, at least at the SBs.
Yes.
And yeah, many people are sorry to see you go.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. And thank you also to all of you who have been supporting me in allowing me, in replicating the messages I have been trying to give out during the subsidiary body meeting sessions, but also in other moments during this very intense period in the area of climate change. Thank you very much.